this is one of those theories which have been mutilated on forums and various other places into something unrecognizable. So using multiple frequencies simultaneously will generate more growth than the same quantum of light in a single frequency. It's misdirected or misinterpreted science, okay. Expecting that you can get some sort of magic multiplier effect by adding a few far red LEDs. We want to have pretty much as much red as possible, because that's the most photosynthetically efficient, by 10 or 15%, but it's more efficient. We want enough blue to keep the plant growth short and dense.
What the hell is the Emerson effect? Well, in this video, we're going to get into it. You're here with Mark Boutwell and Shane from LED Grow. Please remember to like, share, and subscribe, and check us out on Instagram and Facebook, and hit the notifications for future videos like this. If you haven't checked out our $2.99 membership, I highly recommend to do so. Close to 120 members ready and willing to assist you through your growing process. Make sure to hit the join button on the bottom of every video. Okay, so basically today we have a phenomenal guest, Shane, and we just to kind of get into this, you were actually first introduced to me by another grower. We just recently started a grow journal with them, where because he's a first-time grower, and his first yield, he was yielding 180 grams per plant, jumped to 190, just switched to a better LED, implementing a lot of your techniques, and he just yielded over a half pound per plant. And so when you kind of use a 5x5 square feet of space using that over the years, it's been predominantly the square footage for 1,000 watt light, because it covers that amount of space roughly. The 3 pound per light has really been the notorious goal to hit. And really, he introduced me to you. And then from there, I saw you on Mr. Grow, and I was just like, you know what, we really got to get into you, because there's, I think, a lot of efficiencies that still need to be done if people want to go into indoor growing and be competitive in the marketplace. So Dave, do you have any questions, or any of you guys have any questions to start off with?
Shane?
Yeah.
I'd like to ask you about the Emerson enhancement effect. Could you please explain that and how it applies to the PAR spectrum?
Yeah, so this is one of those theories which have been mutilated on forums and various other places into something unrecognizable. So really, the Emerson effect is basically, if you shine just one wavelength of light at a plant with, say, 100 micromoles, you will get, for example, one unit of growth. If you shine it with a different wavelength with 100 micromoles, you'll get 100 units of growth. If you use two of those wavelengths together and shine with 200 micromoles, you'll get maybe 2.1 units of growth. So using multiple frequencies simultaneously will generate more growth than the same quantum of light in a single frequency. And really, it's really experimental stuff, which has almost no bearing on reality, because nobody's going around shining just one narrow band wavelength of light at something. But what people have taken from that, and in particular manufacturers which include far red LEDs and are trying to sell them as a benefit, is that adding far red LEDs, which are less photosynthetically efficient than red or green or blue to start with, that putting energy into those will somehow multiply the growth you're getting from the PAR spectrum, mm-hmm. whereas that Emerson effect is happening within the PAR spectrum in any case. So it's misdirected or misinterpreted science, okay. Expecting that you can get some sort of magic multiplier effect by adding a few far red LEDs. The far red LEDs are less efficient than the red ones, so just add more light. If you want more growth, more light. There's no real magic that occurs at either end of the spectrum where you can kind of, you know, have this little lever that you can, you know, pull that will increase the efficiency of the main photons in the PAR spectrum. So okay. it's a misused term, a misused piece of theory. People searching for solutions where there doesn't need to be solutions. You know, we've got LEDs now, which generate this fantastic spectrum, which is almost tailor-made for exactly what we would want. We want to have pretty much as much red as possible, because that's the most photosynthetically efficient by 10 or 15%, but it's more efficient. We want enough blue to keep the plant growth short and dense, and around 10% is optimum. And lo and behold, you know, 3K color temperature LEDs, it's about 10, 12%. And we want some green in the middle, because it, you know, we get, we can see our plants properly. And also it bounces around within, it goes deeper into the leaves and bounces around. Mm-hmm. There's another one, Dave, I don't know if you can get the graphic up. I put it up on Instagram about a year ago, and it's from a guy called Bruce Bugbee, who's a very renowned scientist in the field. And it's a visualization of different light wavelengths penetrating into a leaf. So you can see,
wow, I want to see that one.
Blue, green, and red photons penetrate into the leaf. And it's quite interesting to see. And so the leaf under the outer layer has a section which has which can photosynthesize, and it's quite deep. Red only barely touches the surface. It doesn't penetrate very much. Blue does a little bit better, and green and far red actually go further down into the leaf. Yeah. So in terms of the sunrise, sunset, I did experiments trying to understand, was there anything in it? And what I did was I put time-lapse cameras into tents. And I was, so plants do move. You know, you see the leaves drooping and raising again during the day. And I was doing the sunset, sunrise thing and different programs, and I couldn't see any difference in the plant's behavior. In terms of the growth rate, you know, what you're doing with the sunrise, sunset thing is you're losing time, you know, you're losing intensity over time. Mm-hmm. So I don't really understand. I think there's a big desire for people to want to find these things, which I can kind of understand. They want to mess around, they want to play with things, and they want to experiment, which is great. But I've never seen anything proven. And you know, I speak a lot to commercial people outside of you know, growing medicinal herbs, and you know, they would just laugh at this stuff. You know, they would be much more industrial focused, you know, in terms of, if you want to grow a plant as much as possible, you maximize the light, you maximize, you know, you maximize everything over the time that you have, and it'd be frivolous to be playing around with things like that.
Let's move on. Look, there's so many questions here. It says the numbers here are these in parentheses. They're not the targets. That's not what I'm trying to get. When I formulate, this would, to me, is the highest I would want to go. I would never want to go above 250 parts per million nitrogen, even in vetch. That's too much. You know, I'd really more like to see 220 is the most I would do.